Okay, so let's start. Last time I wrote an exercise, and I wrote, so this exercise, we have a covering, and we have a mapping from X, continuous mapping. And if you prescribe one point, B, yes. If you prescribe one point for this mapping, okay, with F tilde of x0 equal E0, okay? And then we want to show that this is unique, and it seems that I wrote B connected, okay? But we need X connected here. So F tilde is unique. So it's not B, it's X. If X is connected. Connected. Okay? And probably I wrote B. That's X. We need X is connected. Okay? So the idea is the usual one for connected spaces. You assume you have two liftings, okay? Two different. Well, no, two liftings. And then you take all points in X where they agree. Okay? These two liftings. And there's one point where they agree because we describe in some point here, we say what we want. So this set is not empty. And then what one proves is that this set is where they agree, the two mappings, is connected, open. And also the complement, or it's close. Also the complement is open, and it's non-empty. So if X is connected, it's a whole X, okay? So they agree everywhere. That's the structure of the proof. And so we need X connected for this, okay? I wrote B connected, but we need X is connected, okay? But the idea is this, okay? Take all points where they agree, this is non-empty, open. Complement is also open. X connected implies it's the whole space. So they agree everywhere. So they are equal, the two liftings. So this was just a correction to this exercise. Now I prove a fundamental group of some surfaces. Well, too many folds. But a little bit more general. So this is a surface we start more general. So here's a theorem. We want a two sphere. We have S1, okay? The circle. Fundamental group are the integers. And we gave two applications. One is the Brouwer fixed point theorem, and the other is the fundamental theorem of algebra. Okay? Now you want the other spheres, S2, Sn. So this is a special case of van Kampen theorem. I will not prove the general case, but van Kampen's. It's well known under the name of van Kampen's theorem. So if X is a union, A union B, AB open, the intersection path connected. That's important. So if X is a union of two open sets, and the intersection is path connected, and we choose a base point in the intersection, x0. So then this special case says if pi 1 of A, x0, this is our base point, and also pi 1 of B, this is base point, are trivial. Trivial groups, then also pi 1 of x, x 0. It's trivial. This is a special case of van Kampen theorem. The general van Kampen theorem describes the whole fundamental group, also in non-trivial cases, okay? So proof. So what we have to prove, that every path so let W be an element of the fundamental group of X with base point X0. So W is a path, no? W from 0, 1 to X is a path with a closed path with initial point and final point. It's a base point. X0. We have to prove that W is homotopic to the constant path, okay? We have to prove that W is homotopic, path homotopic to the constant path. So this is constant path in x0. That means the fundamental group has only one element, which is a trivial element, the class of the constant path, okay? So it's a trivial group. Okay. So it's again the lemma, Lebesgue. By the way, if W, so just a remark here, if W from I to S to, no, sorry, back. That comes later, that remark. I was already in an application of this theorem, okay. We will apply then to Sn, to the n-sphere. It's homotopic to constant path. So the Lebesgue number lemma. Applied to the open covering so we have an open covering of X which is AB so we take preimage W minus 1 of A W minus 1 of B this is the open covering of the interval I 0 1 This is a compact metric space, so there's a Lebesgue number associated to this open covering. That means every subset of diameter smaller than the Lebesgue number is contained either here or here. That means the image is contained either in A or in B. Okay? That we applied already for the homotopy lifting lemma, for the path lifting lemma, then the homotopy lifting lemma. Okay. This implies, so we subdivide the interval into small intervals, and such that the diameter of small interval is smaller than the Lebesgue number lemma. So this is a subdivision. So this is T0 equal 0. Smaller than T1, smaller than TL minus 1, oh, strange. Smaller than TL, the last one, which is 1. There's a subdivision of the interval I such that W of each of these small subintervals, let's call them. TI plus 1, sorry, interval, Q
closed interval.
Ti plus 1 is contained in A or in B. It's contained in A or B. Either it's here or it's here, okay? For all I. I equal from what is the first interval where all the substitution from 0 to L minus 1, no? 0 to L minus 1. Alternatingly in A and B. Alternatingly. If one is in A, the next one is in B. Otherwise, we can forget the point in the middle, okay? Alternatingly, in A and B. So an alternatingly means if one is in A, then the next one is in B. Then the next one is in A. If two are in A, we just forget the middle point, okay? Then we have a larger interval, and we are in A. So this is okay. So we can solve that they alternatingly in A and B. That means that the endpoints are all, and the initial points of this are all in the intersection, okay? If one is in A, the next one is in B. So this implies that vi of 0 and vi of wi. Oh, it's not 0, 1. That's a problem here, okay? Because that means that w of ti and w of ti plus 1 are in A intersection B. The initial and final points are all in the intersection. X0 is in the intersection. It starts in the intersection, and then it goes on to the intersection, and then it starts. Okay, maybe I make it. This picture looks like this. So a picture looks like this. This is A. This is B. Here's the base point in the intersection, which is path connected, by the way, that's important. So we start, maybe in A. Then the next is in B, okay? So the endpoint of the first one is in the intersection. Then comes the next one. The endpoint is again in the intersection. Then comes the next one in the next one, okay? And finally, we come back to x0. Here are three pieces, okay, divided in three. So we have a problem with the product a little bit, but I have to. The product of these is not defined in our notation, okay, because our products are defined on the 0, 1, okay, of passes. This is not 0, 1, okay. So we reparametrize linearly this w on this to 0, 1, okay, each of these small. So let let w I be w restricted to ti plus 1. Okay, so this is our original. This is this small little piece here. But we want 0, 1, reparametrized to 0, 1, okay? Reparametrized to 0, 1 in a linear way, but it doesn't matter, okay? So you 0 goes to this, 1 goes to this, and then in a linear way you interpret. So that means wi now goes from the interval 0, 1 to x, okay? And then, So this is W1, no? This is W2. And this is W3. Here are just three of these, okay? Now, then, now the product is well defined, okay? W is homotopic, not equal, of course. It depends on the parameterization. So W, now we have the product. It's well defined of all these, because we have defined the product only for this interval, not for arbitrary intervals. Now we could define it also for others, but it's more or less the same. So W1, now W, where does it start? The first one is, sorry, maybe I missed something. WI goes from TI, so we start from T0, unfortunately. So this is not W1, but W0, no? This is W1, and this is W2, okay? With our notation. I should, because we start with T0 and not with T1, okay? So now the product is defined, W1 times W, how many do we have? L minus 1, no? L minus 1, yes. L minus 1. W is not equal to this. This depends on the parameterization also, okay? On the product, in which order, which is associative. Because this is just a reparameterization of W, okay? This is a reparameterization of W. It's the same path, the image is the same, but we go with different velocities, okay? This is a reparameterization of W. So they are homotopic, okay? This is a, if you reparameterize, the passes are always homotopic. So they are homotopic. The passes are, they are homotopic. This was a homotopic. This was an exercise, okay? If you reparameterize a path, then the homotopy class does not change. Okay. So what? Now we have all these small paths. This is an A, this is in B, this, or let's start in A here, okay? It doesn't matter, A, B. A, this is in B, this is in A, and so on, no? B, A, B. The fundamental group of A and B are trivial, okay? However, these are not closed paths for the moment, okay? That's the problem. So we make them closed, okay? That we can do since A intersection B is path connected. That's the important hypothesis here. It's path connected. Okay, that's, otherwise it's not true. So what do? We go with W0, okay, then we are not in the, in the initial point, unfortunately. So we choose a path which goes from x0 to this endpoint, and we go back. From here we go back to x0. Then for the next one, we go back this path, then we take W1. Then we go back to the x0, then we go back to this again, and then we take the last one in this example, okay? So let whatever it is called, doesn't matter, let Ki from I to A intersection B be a path from x0 to, now we want the endpoint, okay? So WI of the endpoint of 1. So this is W0 of 1, no? This is W1 of 1, the endpoint of these. And here we are closed anyway, OK? So we have to do this from I from 0 to L minus 2 is sufficient, because L minus 1, the last one, finishes anywhere in the right point, OK? So L minus 2 is sufficient here. So I will not make these passes here, because otherwise we cannot see anything here. OK. And then, of course, I may write W is still homotopic to what? So it's W0. So what you said is W0, we close it, OK? So we close it. How is it called? It's K0 minus 1, OK? K0 minus 1. We go back. And then we take K0. OK, and then we take the next one is W1. Then we go back with K1 to the minus 1. Then we go back, and so on. So where does it finish? The last pass is W L minus 1, this goes back to the right point anyway. And this before, what is it?
KL minus 2,
all right. OK. And why is this homotopic here? Because this here is homotopic to constant, OK? And the constant, so we use our lemma, OK? So this is homotopic to a constant path. This is homotopic to a constant path, and so on. So this doesn't matter. I can forget this, OK? This is like a, it's not a closed path, but if you take any path with a constant path, then it's homotopic to this path, OK? So we can cancel this. And then we are left with this, OK? This is a lemma. We proved the lemma. Lemmas, no name. Associativity first, no. We use lemma 1, 2, and 3, OK? When we introduce fundamental group. 1, 2, 3. This is associativity. This is neutral element, OK? And this is inverse. So you look at this lemma. And now, of course, associativity, we may do it in a different way. OK, so I should use colored chalk, which I don't have, but it doesn't matter. So now I make this, of course, this kind of this, and the last one is this. OK? And now all these passes here, 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 and so on, these are closed passes, OK? So this is, these are all closed passes. In A or in B? OK, first one in A, next one in B, and so on and so on. They are all closed passes. But the fundamental group of A and B is trivial, OK, with base point x0. So they are all homotopic to a constant path. They are all homotopic to Cx0. They all go from x0 and go back to x0. So all homotopic to x0. So I may write CX0, 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 CX0. Okay, so W is homotopic to CX0. Which means that W is a trivial element, okay, of the fundamental group. So W is equal to CX. That's the only element of the group. So this means that the fundamental group is trivial, also of X. This is a proof. Again, the Lebesgue number lemma is the main point. Application. That's the end of the proof. Application. So theorem. For n bigger than 1, the fundamental group of Sn with some base point x0 is trivial. So recall, what is Sn? Sn is the n-sphere, unit n-sphere. So these are all points x in Rn plus 1, such that the norm of x is equal to 1. This is the n-sphere. So this is a subspace of Rn plus 1. That's a topology, of course. And this is the unit n-sphere, okay? So this was parentheses. Okay. So proof. So we divide Sn into let Sn plus be all points in Xn. No, let it just be Sn minus the south pole. What is the south pole? 0, 0, minus 1. This is south pole. Okay. And Sn minus be equal Sn minus the north pole, 0, 0, 1. This is north pole. Okay. Then Sn plus is homeomorphic. So this is homeomorphism. To what? Sn minus the south pole is homeomorphic to what? Rn, yes, Rn. And Sn minus is homeomorphic also to Rn. What is the mapping? Famous mapping? Yes, stereographic projection. From the south pole or from the north pole? And this, of course, implies that the fundamental group is trivial, okay? So this implies that pi 1 of Sn plus with some base point x0 and pi 1 of Sn minus base point x0 are trivial. These are trivial groups, okay?
Sn plus intersection Sn minus
is path connected. This is homeomorphic to what? So this is equal to Sn minus 0 both plus minus 1, no?
Both poles.
So this is homeomorphic to Rn minus 1 point. 0, which corresponds to Rn minus 0. Well, yes. So it's Rn minus 0, which is path connected. Why? Since n is bigger than 1, of course, R1, the reals, minus 0, is not path connected, okay? It's not connected even, okay? But R2 minus 0, that's path connected. So since n is bigger than 1, not for n equal 1. This is, but otherwise, we prove that the fundamental group of S1 is trivial, okay? That's not the case. That's the integers. So here you see that the hypothesis that the intersection is path connected is important in the theorem. Otherwise, not true, okay? Otherwise, we prove something also for n equal 1. That's the point here, okay? It's path connected. So the theorem then implies, van Kampen's theorem then implies, pi 1 of the union is x0 is trivial. Okay, that's all. So that's an application of van Kampen's theorem. Now I can, if I want, we have this remark, okay? It's a remark. The S2 pi 1 of S2, let's take the 2 sphere, which we see, okay, in 3 space with some baseband x0 is trivial. That's a surface, that's a 2 manifold, that's why I write, that's a surface, S2, okay, that's a 2 manifold. This is trivial. So I wanted to make this remark. Take any path here, okay? So W is again from I to S2, okay? If, so this initial point and end point, our base point, wherever that is, okay? If W is not surjective, then it's easy that W is homotopic to a constant map. If W is not surjective, that seems strange, no? W from the interval to S2. If W is not surjective, then it is easy to see that W is homotopic to a constant map. Why? So the so here you have, this is a 2 sphere, no? S2. Here's some base point x0. So it's not not surjective, okay, W. We can, by homeomorphism, there's some point not in the image, okay? And then we can assume that it's the antipodal point. Doesn't matter too much, okay? You just take a homeomorphism and you can assume that, but it's not so important. I mean, we don't have, some point is not in the image, okay? And we assume that this point is the antipodal point of x0, that minus x0 is not element in W of I, it's not in the image, okay?
the antipodal point, which is this one. And now we have a path. So they avoid this path, W, okay? So we have a path here which is very complicated, but it never comes to this, okay? To this point. And now what we do, we don't have straight line homotopy here, okay? But now we project W along great circles back to the constant path, okay? That's like straight line homotopy, but on the two-sphere. These are not straight lines, but these are great circles, okay? Now project W back to x0, to the point. Contract W to x0. Along great circles, okay? Along great circles. Of S2. So here's a point. Maybe here's a point, W here, some point. So here's a point of W. So I projecting along this, okay? I have to parameterize from 0 to 1. At 0, everything remains. At 1/2, I go 1/2. At 1, I go all the way back to x0. This is like straight line homotopy, but on S2, which are not really. What is a straight line on S2? No? This is like straight line homotopy. But now along great circles, we don't have segments, okay? Like we have in Rn or something, okay? Along a straight line, but along great circles. But it's very similar, no? I hope you see that, okay? In Rn, you go along the segment back. Here, you go along the circle back, okay? So this implies that W is homotopic to the constant path. This is homotopy. You see the homotopy, okay? You see it. You go. This is missing, and so you shift everything to x0, to the point x0, the whole two-sphere, okay? Between terms 0 and 1. So this is a nice example, okay? So you say, but now it's not surjective, okay? Then we can do this, okay? Unfortunately, passes are very complicated, so there exist surjective passes. This would be otherwise a very easy argument, okay? Unfortunately, there are surjective passes from I to S2. But, so this proof, I mean, we proved it, okay? But van Kampen's theorem, which is not so trivial as this, but there are surjective passes. That seems strange, or no? W from I to S2. Because this seems one-dimensional, no? And this seems two-dimensional. So how do you can get everything? But there are these strange phenomena in mathematics always, okay? So the first famous name is so. There are surjective passes from I to the square in R2, okay? There's a name associated with these kind of passes. Somebody has heard this name? What? Piano curves, yeah. Type piano curves. He constructed such strange surjective mappings from the interval to the square. And then you can go to S2. That's no problem, okay? So this is a remark, okay? In some cases, it's clear if it's not surjective. But what is bad are these bad paths, okay? So then you have to work in some way, okay? And that's, you make it non-surjective maybe, but then you have, it's technical then, okay? Anyway, we proved this in general using Lebesgue number lemma, okay? Okay. So other examples of surfaces.
So we should,
we take Rn minus 0 now, example, other example. Rn minus 0
is homeomorphic to
Rn minus 0 is homeomorphic to Sn minus 1, which is a subspace of Rn minus 0, times the real numbers which are bigger than 0,
okay? The positive real numbers. What is homeomorphism?
So you take a point x here, and then what is this point?
You divide just by the norm, and then you take the norm, okay?
So these are polar coordinates kind of stuff. So x norm.
Okay? That's just what you do.
This is a subspace of Rn, okay? Sn minus 1. So this is a homeomorphism. Rn minus 0 is nothing else than Sn minus 1 times the positive reals, okay? And now there's a general proposition. If you have a product, the fundamental group is easy. If you know the fundamental groups of the, so what? So proposition?
The fundamental group, pi 1, of a product x times y, con base points x 0 times y 0, is isomorphic to the pi 1 of x x 0 times pi 1 of y, y 0.
So this is nice to say. The fundamental group of a product is a product of the fundamental groups, OK? The fundamental group of a product. It's always nice to write informally. The fundamental group of a product is a product.
Well, finite product here, okay? And if it's infinite, you have to think a little bit. Then you have a product, but it's not the product of the fundamental groups, but probably the,
well, whatever, two. Of a product of two spaces is the product of the fundamental groups.
Finitely many.
Okay. Otherwise, there's a difference between if you have abelian groups, for example, with product and sum, okay? Which product is large, the sum is not large, okay? So one has to be careful with this kind of thing. But that's not our. You have two spaces, there's no problem.
So I will not, the proof is, this proof is boring because you just define the natural maps, okay? So we define, you just, there's no, nothing, the quantum is interesting, okay? Lebesgue number, lemma you use and so on, this is,
so you define a mapping from here to the product, pi 1 x, x 0, times pi 1 y, y 0. And you do it in the most natural way. So you have w here, OK? And then you have the two projections, OK? Pi 1 is not so good because we have too many pi 1s. P1 and P2, P1 from x cross y to x, and P2 from x cross y to y, the projections.
Okay, first factor, second factor. And then what we do, we just project our path. We have our path, we have w, and then we project it to x. And we take the path, the class of this. This is here. We just project it. And we project W also to Y, so P2. So we have this element, OK? So what we have to prove? Well, everything is well-defined, maybe, OK? It's well-defined. I will not prove. I mean, if W is homotopic to W prime, then P1W is homotopic to P1W prime. And you take the homotopy P homotopy, OK? You compose everything with P just. So it's well-defined. A homomorphism of groups. Well, if you have a product here, W prime, then what you may first take the product and then project, or first project and then take product, and the result is exactly the same, OK? The passes are the same, OK? Even the passes, not the homotopy. The passes are the same, OK? First the product, then projecting, or first projecting, then taking the product. The result is exactly the same path. This means this is a homomorphism of groups. It's injective. So what is the inverse? Then we have the inverse, of course. Inverse homomorphism. That's maybe the easiest. Inverse isomorphism. Phi. Inverse isomorphism of phi. Is psi from pi 1 x, x 0, times pi 1 y, y 0, to, well, finishing the blackboard, x times y, x 0 times y 0. OK, so what you do is you take w 1 here. And you have a W2 here. And what you take? You take just the product of the passes now, OK? W1 times, in this sense, the product. OK, W, not the product of passes. In this sense, the product. So W1 times W2 of t of a point is, of course, W1 of t times W2 of t. OK? So if you go by this and then you project, then you get back W1 and W2, OK? And also the other way around. First this, then phi is the identity. First phi, then this is the identity, OK? OK. That's the whole proof. So this, there's no idea. It's just formal, OK? However, this means then corollaries. Pi 1 of R2 minus 0 so it's isomorphic to pi 1 of S1 times pi 1 of R positive. No, I forgot the baseboard. Well, I have a problem with baseboards now, because well, I take x0 and s1 anyway here, OK? It takes the same x0. And here, I don't know what to take. What group is this? What? What is this? So this is, yeah, and this? The positive is trivial, no? Straight line homotopy, trivial group. Well, I don't write 0. I don't know what 0 is, OK. Trivial group, whatever is, OK?
This is again straight line homotopy. So this is pi 1 of S1 x0.
Okay, this remains. So this is that.
And I mean, you project onto S1, right? So the isomorphism is again given by rotation number, okay? You have first, you are in R2 minus 0, and then you project to S1, and you on S1 you have the rotation number, okay? Which doesn't change. So isomorphism is given again. By the rotation number. You define it in this way, okay? That's it. And then you call it rotation number. Around zero here, okay? Rotation, you are how many times you go around zero, okay? And that you see projecting to S1, and then how many times you go around S1, okay? And that you get by lifting to the reals and the paths from zero to some integer. And this integer is a rotation number, okay? That's the isomorphism. Okay, so this. This is also a surface, of course, but non-compact. The other fundamental groups are trivial. No, I don't write. If you take Sn minus zero, okay, Rn minus zero, then it's trivial, okay, fundamental group. Another corollary of another surface is S1 cross S1. This has a name, this surface. Yeah, the torus. Except it's not so clear where this is living, this torus, okay? If you have it in this way, we have S1 cross S1 is contained in C times C, or R2 times R2 in this version, no? C times C, which is, if you want, R4, okay? It's a subspace of this, okay? This is one version. But of course, you can do it in R3, okay? But not, this is a very canonical way, okay? And then you have this in R3, and you make this picture. This is one S1, the first, and the second one is this. This is another S1. And if you take the product of this S1 with the second S1, you get exactly the torus, right? So this is not equal maybe, but it's homeomorphic to S1 cross S1. Okay? But this is living in R3, okay? Formally, it's living in R4. Did you do differential geometry? Not yet. Second semester, yeah. Because this is an interesting torus. There are many tori, okay? And then you have all types of curvatures, okay, flying around. All types of curvatures, that we will do. Torus main example, okay, in differential geometry. S2 is the first one, and the second one is a torus, okay, at the surface. And then you have all kinds of curvatures, okay? Positive, negative, where you have this kind of points, and zero, okay? How are they called? Yeah, curvatures, okay. Whatever that is. This torus in R4 is a very special torus because this, what is curvature here? Well, whatever it is, this is a, has curvature zero always, okay? It's a flat torus. This is a flat torus. This is not flat. Here's curvature, okay? So seen from point of view of differential geometry, this torus in R3 and this torus in R4 are very different, okay? From differential geometry. This torus in R4 has curvature zero, okay? It's a flat torus. Flat means curvature zero. This torus in R3 has all, it's not possible with curvature zero, this, okay? You always have some curvatures, okay? So, but this is differential geometry. Anyway, that you will see.
The most interesting torus is maybe this one. It's a flat torus, okay? It has no curvature, this one. Whatever two curvatures. It's locally like R2 in R4. Okay? It looks locally exactly like R2.
It's square.
What?
Square.
Well, you want to make this identification. Well, anyway, pi 1 of S1 cross S1, whatever, 1 times 1, I can write now, it's orthomorphic to pi 1 of S1, 1 times pi 1 of S1, 1. So this is isomorphic to Z times Z. So this is written as Z square. That's the fundamental group of the torus. And you see the isomorphism, because you project a path first on, if you have a path here, first you project onto this S1, and see how many times do I run around this. And then you project onto this S1, and then you see how many times do I run this. And that's, you have to get two integers, two rotation numbers now, one around this and one around this, with the two projections, okay, from S1. To cross S1 to the first S1 and then to the second S1. Okay? Two rotation numbers. And this is Z2. That's the isomorphism. That's okay? More or less. Well, the projection is defined, no? From S1 to the first. And then you have a path, and then you project this path. And then you are running just around this S1, no? And you count how many times do I run, okay? And then you do the same here. So you get two integers. And these are the two rotation numbers, okay? And this is the isomorphism. So corollary, so this is the corollary. The fundamental group is this, okay? And so, so you have another corollary that they are not homeomorphic. No, and this is completely clear to everybody. But S2 and the torus, S1 cross S1. So as a surface, of course, we want to be in R3. That's our space where we see what is a torus, right? So we make the picture here. In R4, you have to imagine how it looks in R4. Are not homeomorphic. Why not? The fundamental group of S2 is trivial. And the fundamental group of S1 is Z2. So they have different fundamental groups, okay? They, of course, they are path connected, so it doesn't depend even on the base point. So this is a proof that they are not homeomorphic. S2 and the torus, okay? If you want to do that in a direct way, it gets somewhat not so easy, okay? The fundamental group is okay. So you call S2 is the surface of genus, is the orientable surface. Of genus 0. That's what also called, no? And S, the torus, what is this? The orientable surface of genus 1. And then maybe you see what is the orientable surface of genus 2. Maybe it's a picture. One picture is this. Now you have two of these, okay? Orientable surface of genus 2. And so on. So you see the orientable surfaces, okay? Orientable surface of genus 2. And so on. There are also non-orientable surfaces, okay? And now I will introduce a non-orientable surface. So what is a real projective spaces? I want to define real projective space. So you did geometry, okay? Projective geometry. So if you have a vector space, you have associated a projective space, okay? Associated to each vector space. That's projective geometry. R3, for example, okay? There's a vector space. So real RP2, RPN. That's my notation, RPN. RP2. In geometry, what do you take as a set? The projective space associated to R3 is this, okay? So you take all lines, in R3 through zero, okay? All lines in R3 through zero. These are the points, okay? And in general, for any vector space, you take all lines in the vector space, all subspaces of dimension one. That's the same, okay? All subspaces of R3 of dimension one. That's what it is. In geometry, in projective geometry. That's the definition in projective geometry. Now we notice that I want a topological space now. Well, all subspaces of dimension one. Each line through zero intersects the two sphere in two points. Okay? So this is a remark. Each line through zero intersects S2, which is okay, in two antipodal points. No, clear. In two antipodal points. Then, as a set, I take equivalence relation on S2. Okay, equivalence relation on S2. So I give the equivalence classes. That's an equivalence relation. I just give the equivalence classes, okay? So equivalence classes are x minus x. X and S2. So this is a class of x. Equivalence class of x. Contains two points, which are antipodal points. We want to say this is one element only, okay? And then we have, as usual, we have a canonical projection from S2 to this so we have a canonical projection P from S2 to the equivalence class. And that's RP2. RP2, our definition. What is this? This is equivalence class of x, x in S2. And this is just x minus x, 2 points. Each equivalence class has 2 points. So the mapping is P of x is the equivalence class of x, obviously. Okay? Each point goes to its equivalence class. So this is, if you want, our definition, no? But this corresponds to the definition of geometry, no? Where you have lines, but each line intersects S2 in these 2 points. So as sets, they are bijective in a natural way, okay? the lines now in on S2 correspond to these pairs, right? So it's the same set. And now we have a topology. So what S2 is a subspace of R3, so we have a topology, subspace, no? We have a topology here, and we want a topology here. So what to define? Quotient. The only reasonable way in general is a quotient topology. So let the quotient topology. So V in RP2 is open. What is the definition of quotient topology? If and only if P, yes, P minus 1 of V is open in S2. So this is what, which topology is this? Quotient topology. This is the finest topology on RP2 such that P is continuous, okay? The finest topology. So this is an exercise on quotient topology. The finest topology on RP2 such that P is continuous. Okay, that's a quotient topology, okay? And then this is a, you can do the same for Sn, okay? RPn, exactly the same. I did it for S2, okay? Then P from S2 to RP2 is a covering. So here's S2. That's easy to make a picture, okay? Now I have to identify antipodal points. That becomes one point, okay? So P projection, okay? Well, I can represent everything on the lower hemisphere, right? A representative. But I still have to identify something here, okay? Because still here we have antipodal points, which we have to identify, no? Right? And then I cannot make a good picture. This, of course, is homeomorphic to the disk. No, that's a projection, okay? And then I have to identify antipodal points on the disk, okay? So I have to identify, still to identify antipodal. This is maybe, so here you have mod, still mod equivalence relation. Okay. You still have to identify to stock of equivalence class. This is maybe the standard presentation of projective space. Okay, a disk where on the boundary you have to identify antipodal points. You cannot make a picture, a good picture in R3. You can try, but it looks okay. So what means covering? Covering means just, given any point here, I take a small neighborhood, U, okay? And how does the pre-image of this U look like? Well, you get one copy here, no? Okay? So, and you get one copy on the other side, no? So here, on the other side, right? This. So this is P minus one of U. Of what? U, yes, I called it U. So this is evenly covered, okay? And this is a small disk. These are two small disks, okay? That's all. Open disks, open sets, doesn't matter. So this is a covering, twofold covering. Each fiber has two elements, okay? That's covering.
Twofold covering. Each fiber has two elements.
And these are antipodal points, okay?
Antipodal points, the two elements.
You recall, if this is connected, then each fiber has the same number of elements, okay? That's what I proved, okay? This is connected. This is connected. This is surjective. This is path connected, sorry, path connected, okay? This is path connected. Well, it's connected. So I prove for connected, no? If the base is connected, then each fiber has the same number of elements, okay? Here it's two.
So theorem,
that's a surface. This RP2 is a surface, okay? It's a two-manifold. Because each point has a neighborhood, which is like an homeomorphic to an open disk in R2, okay? You maybe say these points are strange, this point, no? But it doesn't matter. I can make this where I want, okay? I can make it this. I can avoid my points, okay? That's not the problem.
Okay, so theorem. Pi 1 of RP2, x0. So I take some class here now already, okay? It's isomorphic to Z2. So this is, by definition, Z mod 2Z.
So a group is two elements, okay? This is a group with two elements. The fundamental group of RP2 is the group with two elements. And in the same way, you prove RPN. I didn't define RPN, so, but it's exactly the same, RPN. You do everything the same, and this is also... Well, I have to be careful. Well, I will prove this, but the same for RPN, but we have to be careful with RPN a little bit. So I may give this remark as an... So we define in a similar way, define RPN.
RPN is all classes x in Sn now. No? So these are again antipodal points, x minus x.
And then we have also here a projection from Sn to RPN, the same kind of projection, Px equal class of x. And this is also twofold covering. Okay. So you define RP2. I did RP2, no? RPN, you define in a similar way. There's one interesting special case. This is RP1.
Example, RP1 is equal,
so the question is, what is RP1? That should be one manifold. One manifolds are very easy, no? So
this is X, or classes, but X now is in S1. So just, again, x and minus x.
So what you have to do is, you have to identify, this is S1. And you have to identify antipodal points, right? This becomes one point, okay? So if you do this, this you can see, what do you get? So what I can forget half of these, okay? Then I have each equivalent class still. But I still have to identify these two points, okay? These are the remaining points which I have to identify to one class. This, this, and this becomes one class. And now if you identify these, what do you see? So you can do it, okay, in R2. And what do you see? S1. You see the S1 sphere. The one sphere, okay? And that's true. RP1 is just the one sphere, S1. RP1 is S1. So a remark. This implies RP1 is homeomorphic to S1. They're just the one sphere. That's a special case, okay? And now you say maybe RP2 is a two sphere. No, that's not the case. But how to prove that? Well, I wrote the theorem, which unfortunately, okay, the two sphere has trivial fundamental group, and the one sphere and the RP2, okay. So a corollary. Here we have another surface, and this means S2, RP2 is not homeomorphic. RPN. Well, this is true for N also. RP2 is not homeomorphic. S2. Why not? Because S2 has trivial fundamental group and RP2 has Z2. This is not the same group, okay? So RP1 is S1, but RP2 and S2 are very different, okay? In fact, RP2 is a non-orientable surface of genus well, I always forget of genus 1. This is 1. This is the first of the non-orientable surfaces. What is the second one? The next one? That has still a name. What? I didn't understand. I still don't understand the name. No. Möbius band is with boundary, okay? Here we have without boundary. There's no boundary, okay? Möbius band is closely related to RP2, okay? But this is with boundary. Surface with boundary, without boundary, no? We have without boundary. Other surfaces, of course, is a disk, two disk, no? But this has a boundary, okay? So I didn't mention the two disk. S2 are closed surfaces without boundary, okay? The torus has no boundary, okay? Whatever that is. So not RP2. There's one more famous name of a surface. So you have the two sphere, you have the torus, the Lorentzian ones. You have the projective plane, this one, no, RP2. And then the next one is the Klein bottle. That's what it's called, okay? Klein bottle, whatever that is. But maybe you heard this name, no? If you hear surfaces, so Klein bottle, I don't define, but this is the next one. Is non-orientable surface of genus 2. Okay, that's the Klein bottle. That's another name. Then they have no names. Then it's the next one is the non-orientable surface of genus 3 and so on and so on and so on. But without special names. The first one is a projective plane. The second one is a Klein bottle, okay? The non-oriental ones. And the oriental ones is the two sphere and the torus, the next one. Without boundary, okay? Closed, without boundary only. Well, anyway. So proof. Of what? What do we have to prove? The theorem, right? Of π1 of R. Well, I write even RPN here now. It doesn't matter. X0 is isomorphic to Okay. Is isomorphic to Z2. But here I have to be careful. There's one special case, okay? If n is equal to 1, this is S1. So it's Z, okay? So for n bigger than 1, then it's always Z2 for the higher ones, okay? The only exception is so pi 1 of RP1 with x0 is isomorphic to pi 1 of S1. They are homeomorphic with some base point, whatever that is, x0. And this is that. That's the exception, okay? Otherwise, it's. Okay. So now let's prove it. What would be interesting is the classification, to do the classification of surfaces, okay? All closed surfaces. However, we don't have enough time for that, okay? That's an interesting point, okay? To classify surfaces. That's a classical argument. Some combinatorial argument, of course. You need some combinatorics here, okay? You have to present the surface in a good way by triangulation. So we take the covering, P. I'm doing the case RP2, okay? But the case RPn, for n bigger than 1, is the same. We will have to see where n equal 1 is not good, okay? Maybe. So RP2 to S2. No, that's the wrong direction. From S2 to RP2. So P of x is the class of x. And the class of x consists of two points, which are antipodal points. So this is a twofold covering. What do we have to prove? We have to prove this one. So I define a map from pi 1 of RP2 with base point x0. So x0 is a point in S2. I want an isomorphism with Z2, okay? And Z2 I write multiplicatively, okay? So I write, what is this multiplicative? This is 1 and minus 1, and with a product. So this is isomorphic to Z2. The same group, no? With two elements always. So I want to define this mapping. So I take a class here, W. It's the same proof as for S1 now, okay? You will see. Not exactly the same. The structure is exactly the same, but we need something else. It's a little bit more difficult, maybe even, because we have used the theorem before. So what is W? W is a path. WI from RP2 is a path with initial point and end point, the class of the point x0. And x0, recall, were a point in S2, which projects to its class. So what did we do? We use a path lifting lemma to get a lifting. Let W tilde from I to S2 be a lifting. So this is a path lifting lemma of W with initial point W tilde of 0. So I have to take a point which projects to the class of x0, so I take x0, obviously, okay? x0, which is a point in S2, fixed point in S2. Let W be a lifting of W with this. Then, what is W? Then, W tilde of 1, the endpoint. What is the endpoint? If you project, it becomes a closed path, okay? W is a closed path, right? We lift it. This is x0. So what are the two possibilities for the endpoint of x0? Two possibilities, x0 or minus x0. Yes. So this is epsilon x0, where epsilon is equal to 1 or epsilon is equal to minus 1. Okay? X0, the same, or minus x0. These are the two points which project to our base point here. Okay? And now I can define my mapping. I didn't give a name, phi. So I introduce a name here, phi, from this. Okay. Now I define phi. So let phi of w be, this is the definition. So what do you take? Epsilon. If it goes to x0, the lifting, then we take 1. If it goes to minus x0, we take minus 1. So it's epsilon in 1 minus 1. We just take this epsilon. We look where does it finish. Okay? So that's the definition of this mapping phi. And now we just only have to prove that phi. Well, phi is now it's the same as before. So then what we have to prove. The first is phi is well defined. And this is the homotopy lifting lemma, okay? By the homotopy lifting lemma. The same as before. Or its corollary. If I is well defined by the homotopy lifting, or its corollary. That's the next important step, okay? Then, phi is a homomorphism of groups. I don't know how much time do I have. Not too much time. So, I don't prove it. It's the same as for the reals. In the reals, one pass, you have to translate, okay? Now, if the first pass ends in minus x0, you have to multiply the second pass with minus 1. So it starts in minus x0, okay? It's the same otherwise, okay? So the time is more or less finished, so I don't write that now. So phi is, this is now interesting. Phi is injective. So this I will do. Well, it's also the same as before, except we have to see the difference between n equal 1 and n bigger than 1. No, I'm doing the case 2, but it's otherwise it works for every. So phi is injective. So let w be in the kernel of phi. Okay? And we have to prove it's trivial. The kernel is trivial, no? So what does it mean? This implies that w tilde of 1, the endpoint of w of the lifting, which point is it? It goes to 1, so x0 also. It's 1 times x0. So this is x0. Okay? Epsilon is equal. Epsilon of w is equal to 1. So this is, of course, is also the endpoint, no? By definition. This is by definition. So this means W is closed. This means W tilde is closed, is a closed path. Where? In S2. So W tilde is an element where in the fundamental group of S2 with base point x0. And now this is more difficult than in the case of S1. This is a trivial group, okay? In the case of S1, we have the reals here, okay? And this is trivial by straight line homotopy. Here, this is a trivial group. This is a trivial group. That means that W is equal to the trivial element. W tilde, sorry. W tilde, there's only one element, which is the constant path in the point x0, no? That's the only element of the trivial group. So this implies that W tilde is homotopic to Cx0 by a homotopy H. They are homotopic, and now I project. So this implies that W, which is a projection of W tilde, is homotopic to the projection of Cx0 projected. What is this? This is the constant path now in the class of x0, RP2. And the homotopy, of course, is H and then projected. So this is trivial, this step, okay? What is not trivial here is this fact here, okay? This is an addition to the... So this means that W is the class, many parentheses here. W is also the trivial class, okay? And this means the kernel is trivial. So this implies the kernel of phi is trivial. And this, of course, means that phi is injective. Okay. And then the last thing is surjective, okay? Surjective is trivial again. So the last thing is phi is surjective. So it's the same as before. Maybe I do that, two lines. We have to get minus 1, okay? Phi goes to 1 minus 1. 1 we get, no? That's the unit element we get from the unit element in any case, no? So we have to get minus 1. So let U be any path, be a path in S2 from x0 to minus x0. Well, there's no problem, no? It's path connected. We go on the great circle, okay? In one or in the other direction. There are two ways not to go on the great circle. Let u be a path in S2 from x0 to minus 1, and w be the projection of u. So this means w is closed path, is a closed path. So it represents an element in the fundamental group of pi 1 of RP2 with base point x0, the class of x0. It's a closed path. And now what is phi of W tilde? So W tilde of 1. What is W tilde? This is just U, because we projected from U, okay? And now we lift back, so we get back U, okay? W is a projection of U, no? W is a projection of U. So we lift back, we get back U, okay? So W tilde. So W tilde of 1 is equal to U of 1 is equal to minus 1. By our choice, okay? And this implies phi of W is minus 1. No, minus, this is minus x0, yes, thank you. And phi of w is minus 1. Yes, exactly. Okay? And this, we get minus 1 in the image, and this means phi is surjective. And that's the end of the proof, okay? The main difference between this and the case of S1 is that the fundamental group of R is trivial, and that's easy. The fundamental group of S2, we have to prove that it's trivial, okay? And that's not completely trivial, okay? That's van Kampen. We use van Kampen theorem, a special case, okay? So this, now we have many surfaces. Now we have RP2. That's a projective plane, it's called also, okay? Fundamental group con two elements. We have S2 fundamental group trivial. So this is in some sense to finish. So fundamental groups, our surfaces, fundamental groups. So we have the surfaces, S2 is trivial. We have torus. This is Z times Z. We have RP2. So this is the surface. And this is a fundamental group. So we have what else? RP2. This is called the projective plane, no? Projective plane also. Okay? That's a projective plane, real projective plane, if you want. Fundamental group is what? Z2. Not this Z2, but this Z2, okay? Well, that's it for the moment. I cannot, we don't have others, okay? So this is. So they are not homeomorphic, okay? They are not homeomorphic. These three are not homeomorphic. Okay, that's application, okay, of fundamental group. This is difficult to prove without fundamental group, okay? It's not so easy to prove that these are different here, okay, otherwise, okay? The fundamental group is nice for this, okay? And also for the other surfaces, by the way. Fundamental group here is the most important invariant, okay? Algebraic invariant. That's a fundamental group. And so Thursday we have last lecture, no? Thursday. Thursday from, not tomorrow, no? Thursday from 11 to 13. And then I will finish with homotopy equivalence, maybe, probably. Maybe I talk also about Möbius band, okay? That's also an interesting example, but it's a surface with boundary, and we will see also the Möbius band, okay? What? Is it? This? Well, more or less distributed. So you have, yeah, it's in the book more or less, but it's in different chapters. I'm not going in a linear order through the book here, okay? Because there's not enough time to do everything in the book, okay? It should be in the book, yes. Projective spaces, real projective plane. That is in the book, yes. Van Kampen's theorem, in some version, it's later, in the later chapters, okay? Yeah, in some way it's everything in the book, but distributed. You don't, okay? I went a little bit diagonal to this, because we had only 5 hours, no, of this part, and if you follow one chapter, then, okay? But the important things are these, no? The fundamental group of S1, okay, the fundamental group of S2, Sn, okay, fundamental group of the torus as a product, that's easy, fundamental group of RPn, okay, of project, these are nice examples. What we should see maybe also next time is, these are all abelian groups, right? All abelian groups, okay? So you may ask, but why do we see only abelian groups, okay? So we should give one example of a space which is non-abelian fundamental. So that I will do Thursday also. At least one example, okay? And typically, fundamental groups are not abelian, okay? Abelian groups are easy. But fundamental group can be everything, okay? So in general, it's not abelian. Here it happens that for these first easy cases, okay, it's always abelian, trivial abelian groups, okay? But if you go on with other surfaces, it becomes immediately non-abelian and gets more difficult, okay? So I will give one example of non-abelian fundamental group also next time. Okay, that's it.